first thing I do is make a detent pin. This will hold the loading gate open and shut. It will also keep the loading gate from coming out of the frame. A small spring will hold tension on the back of the pin, and a set screw will hold the spring in. To make the spring, I just use a piece of music wire and wrap it around another piece of music wire. You can get music wire at your local hobby store. Pocket is plunge cut into the hammer. This will be for the firing pin. And now the firing pin is made. The firing pin fits perfectly, and now I have to drill a hole through the side of it to hold it in place. Now that the anchoring pin is drilled, the pocket for the firing pin can be enlarged. I'll explain why in a moment. This enlarged pocket allows the firing pin to pivot. Because the firing pin travels in an arc, the firing pin would not be allowed to enter the frame correctly. With the firing pin made like this, the firing pin can enter the frame, and as the hammer rotates into position, the pin can pivot into place. small piece of music wire is used as a retaining pin. Now I use a piece of music wire to kind of eyeball the firing pin so it's square in the vise. And then I drill a hole partway through the pin. This hole is for a spring that will keep the firing pin in its pivoted down position. If this spring wasn't there, the centrifugal force would force the pin in its upward position, and it would hit the frame. There are several other ways you could deal with this, like making the firing pin curved, or putting the firing pin in the frame. This is just how I chose to deal with it. Next, I drill a hole through the handle. A small pin of music wire will go through the aluminum part of the handle and into the wood part of the handle to keep them from moving. A small disc is turned with a hole down the center of it. This will become the handle portion of the ejector rod. The ejector rod housing and the barrel are used to mark out the odd-shaped bird-beaked handle the Single Action Army is known for. Then the barrel section is milled out. use a hacksaw to get off all the extra unnecessary bits. And then a belt sander to define its shape even more. And then it was finished up with files. A piece of music wire will be used as the rod portion of the ejector rod. It will be a press fit, so no adhesive will be needed. The excess is cut off. Another music wire spring is made by using a reamer as a mandrel and wrapping music wire around it. And that completes the ejector. This little piece of steel will become the front sight. I use a ball end mill to carve out a small radius on the bottom of it. The same ball end mill will carve out the blade on the other side. The front sight is then silver soldered into place. I actually burned the piece of wire that was holding it in place in half. So I ran a wire down the back side of the sights up to the front to align it and just moved it around with a pair of needle-nose pliers. While the barrel was still relatively hot, I hit it with a wire brush. The excess solder came off fairly easy because it was still soft and gummy. Next, I start to make the base pin. This is the small plunger type pin that holds the cylinder pin in. Drilled and tapped. The second half is single point threaded. Cut slots into it and harden it just like every other screw. And made a small music wire spring. The revolver is now mechanically complete. I don't have access to real bluing tanks, so I had to cold blue the gun. In the past, I've always used cold blue with cotton balls, and the directions on the cold blue say not to use cotton balls, to use like old t-shirts and stuff. Yeah, well that sucked. The cotton balls worked much better. So I ended up submerging like half the parts just to get them to cover completely. After all that, I ended up with something like this. I'm double checking to make sure the bolt is locking correctly. It's a new gun that I don't trust yet, so I figure better safe than sorry, but it does seem to be working correctly. That's all for this project. Please like, subscribe, and comment.